Three, two, one. Fala galera!
Bienvenidos amigos!
That's Spanish and Portuguese.
Well, always stuck it this way. So we say something. Sometimes we change. Yeah. He says in Portuguese, I say in Spanish. But guys, today I'm so happy to have here with us Anto Wilk.
Yes.
I said to you that I always do like stupid jokes, right?
Yes.
I said that was the W is like upside down of milk, but...
Okay. Sure.
Hey, Anto, thank you so much for coming here for a second hour invitation. I'm so happy. As I said for you, I love your work.
Thank you.
It's completely different from what you see, you know, the photographers and everything that you look on Instagram.
Sure, thank you.
So I love what you have been doing so far, and especially here in Perth, that sometimes we realize it's not every place that we have that's beautiful to take some photos.
Sure.
And you do something really amazing.
Thank you. Cheers. Thanks for the invite as well. I think shooting in Perth can make you a good photographer or it can make you quit.
That's a good point.
Yeah. In many respects, I mean, if you know, if you're going to do beach shots, you've got so many opportunities. But outside of that, mountains, you've got a couple, but you've got to drive a long way.
A lot, hey.
Street, very difficult because you've got two roads that just run parallel, or two or three, and that's the city. There's not many quirky alleyways there like you might see in Tokyo or New York or London. You know, it's not a developed city, so
yeah,
you've really got to think about composition.
Composition.
Yeah.
It's good the way that you're saying, because I don't know if you realize we stopped like for 1 week our podcast.
Sure.
So I took my first vacation for I don't know how long, a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So I took like 1 week. I went to Melbourne.
Yeah. Okay. So much better.
Oh man, it's
you need that.
It's
you
complicated
need to.
Because
yeah.
Every place that you see, every place like bridge, the buildings, and drive one hour, you have like big valleys.
Sure,
it's
sure.
Beautiful.
Yes.
It's
yes.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Perth is amazing.
Yeah.
The only thing is not everything that you want to do is not close.
Sure, sure.
But
yeah.
But that's why I said to you, you do something amazing, like in a really tight space.
Yeah, yeah.
If I can say that.
Yeah, way. Yeah, sure. No, I feel it. I posted something yesterday, and because I've shot in Perth for so long,
mm-hmm.
Is it going now? I think you was. When I started shooting, you was already shooting, and I said in the message, you did that shot at the Henge on St. George's Terrace years ago with the sun coming directly down it. And that's when I started, so I don't know how long you have been shooting previously to that, so maybe 5 years now. And after 5 years, I've run out of ideas. So I posted the other day and I said, it's been slow this year. And that there's been a lot of thinking, but little produced, and I think that's just because I need to rethink my photography, composition wise.
Taking these that you just said to me now, there is one point that I realize, like or not, our life as a photographer is kind of lonely, right?
Sure.
We don't. Generally, you don't work with other people.
Sure.
Because other people, they have their own time and you have your own creativity.
Yeah.
Do you think because we always do this by ourselves, if we start to do something more collaborative, that could spark a little bit more the creativity? Or
that's a good question. And I've thought about that before. And sometimes when I go out with people, it's harder for me to take good pictures. I come back I'm disappointed with most of the pictures when I go out with a group of people. Having said that though, if you can get used to going out with shooting with people, I'm absolutely sure you can become a better photographer for it, yeah.
Why do you think that happens? Because you have to have your own time, you have to thinking on the composition?
Yeah.
Or maybe when you go in a place, do you have already like the framing you want in your head, or you have to be on the place, study the location, and that's the place?
Yeah, I think you're spot on with most of that. If I'm out with people, I find them distracting.
Okay.
I like to really get into it, be immersed into it, be myself, be a little bit weird. Because sometimes to get shots that you want, people do look at you kind of strange. You might kneel down, you might bend down funny, you might creep around the corner or something. And having other people around kind of, for me personally, it's kind of distracting. And when I do go out by myself, I can visit a place 3 times in a week. I can go back, I haven't got exactly what I wanted. I didn't fill the frame with the pieces that I want. So initially I'll go out, I'll look for compositions. I'll try not to have something in my mind initially. Because if I do that, then I cut myself off to other opportunities, other compositions, and my mind becomes very narrow.
Uh-huh.
And I'll just go straight to the one thing that I wanted, and I won't stop until I get it. That can work against me because I'm not really exploring different ideas.
Gotcha.
And so once I've gone out initially the first time, if I haven't got anything, I'll go back, I'll look at my images. Say somebody there, the light here, uh-huh. The light there, the camera lower. I don't consider myself a great photographer because I can't get it the first time. That's just the way I think about my ability. And then after, two or three times, maybe I'll get something then.
So the way that you're saying, do you dream sometimes with the photo that you want to take?
Yes.
Because you go in different place or the same place like 2 or 3 times?
Yeah. And sometimes that can be before I go out. And sometimes that's after I've been out and I've seen something. Yeah. And usually if I go out and I've dreamt of something, it's not really good for photography. Because then I'm setting an expectation level, which sometimes you can't reach. And and you become narrow-minded and disappointed at the same time. You're like, oh no, I'm not doing a great job here.
How often do you get disappointed with yourself?
Quite often. I'm trying to retrain myself to think differently. I think when you start off anything new, it's important to take time at the beginning. I really rushed photography in the mm-hmm. beginning. I was so excited to go out and take pictures that I didn't really take my time.
Mm-hmm.
And now I've accumulated some bad habits that when I go out, I can't kind of step out of them, and then I have to go, oh yeah, step out of that habit.
Oh really?
Yeah. Like shooting the same composition all the time.
So would say that you are a perfectionist?
Yes. 100%. Unfortunately.
So Anto, tell me about it. I know that you are not from Perth.
Yeah.
Right. Where are you from originally?
Originally from close to Manchester,
mm-hmm.
a town called Blackburn, in the UK.
Okay. Yeah. You used to be a photographer over there?
No, not a photographer.
Why you came to Perth?
I've actually been asked that before and I've got no answer. I just decided I wanted to come to Australia.
Okay.
Yeah. A lot of people in the UK, they have a dream to come here, and mm-hmm. it's mainly because of the weather.
Oh, yeah.
So miserable in the UK. It's always grey, cloudy.
You can pretty much do the opposite.
Yeah.
It's sunny days almost every day.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. And the funny thing is I don't even go out in summer anymore because I've got, I'm fair-skinned. Winter's my time. I absolutely love it when it rains here.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Which is not much.
No, it's not much. But, now I enjoy it.
Oh, cool, man. Tell me a little bit more, for example, this journey. When we start here, when you arrive here in Perth, what sparked your desire or inspiration to be a photographer?
I just had this thought that it'd be cool to get a camera and take pictures.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't inspired by Instagram or anything like that.
Uh-huh.
I've always been creative. My strongest subjects at school were art, graphic design. I didn't do great at school, so they were my favourite subjects. I didn't really concentrate on much else.
Uh-huh.
And then as I grew up, I always went into the creative side of things. I was DJing for a little while, produce music for a little while. I always used to love to draw when I was younger, uh-huh. mainly copying, but drawing. So it just felt natural to do something like that, to create something. And so when I came here in 2013, I just decided I was going to buy a camera. No idea what was going on with the camera, no settings. So I bought a Samsung Galaxy camera, uh-huh. touchscreen, which had a fixed lens, automatic zoom, which was times 10.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And I just went pointing, shooting everywhere up until 2016. So about 3 years, I didn't really get into photography.
So everything was automatic?
Yeah.
You're just taking pictures?
Yeah. No composition rules. I knew nothing.
The way that you said that, if you are a perfectionist, yeah. and if you look at your photos that you took that time now,
I don't
you're going to kill yourself.
I don't look at it.
That never happened with me, eh?
No, never.
Man, we look at our photos like from, I don't know, from 3 or 4 years ago, I say, oh my God.
Yeah, and it's a crazy dynamic that you can look at your own pictures and feel embarrassed about them. It's so strange that we actually do that. And yet it's to be expected when you start something that it's bad.
Yeah.
You know.
You were doing this for 3 years.
Yeah.
And what was the moment that you say, okay, let's take this serious, I'm going to start to learn properly the settings. What was the moment that you say, okay, cool, let's do this. I'm not saying professionally, I don't know if that was the way that you went to go, but okay. how you start to change this mindset and say, oh, let's do this properly.
Yeah, there's actually a defining moment when that happened. So in those 3 years before I bought a DSLR, I would go out, take pictures, and then I would get frustrated, and then I would try to look for information online, but for some reason I couldn't internalize it properly. All the settings, all the numbers that came with it, I was like,
what is that?
Yeah, what is that? I put the camera down, I picked it up, I put it down, I picked it up in those 3 years, sometimes 6 months, sometimes 2 months. And then my girlfriend, she is from Japan. We went to visit her family. And I told her, right, I'm getting a camera and I'm going to take pictures in Japan. So bought a Nikon D5600, went to Japan, knew nothing about RAW files, just looked on Instagram, took a couple of pictures, and I goes, I am a terrible photographer. And I put the camera back away until March 2017. So we went at Christmas, so 3 months uh-huh, later, uh-huh. and I just decided that I was going to give it time. In March, I decided that's it, I'm just going to give it time, let the concepts of photography sink in, and then I'm going to start taking pictures again, and that's when it happened.
When you say that you're going to have like the concept sinking, did you use anything to learn, or what was your source for you to learn about photography?
Just the internet, just Google and YouTube.
Watching films, everything.
Yeah. It took a while. I found it confusing, to be honest with you. Because there's so much to know about photography, uh-huh. I personally tried to take it all on, which was a crazy idea, but I didn't know which direction photography went in and what was what. So you've got landscape, street, portraits, all these different genres of photography. Uh-huh. Then you've got the technical aspect, and you confuse which technical aspect is going to take me down that way, uh-huh. and which technical aspect is going to take me down that way. And I didn't really know what style of photography I wanted to do, so I tried to absorb it all.
So you changed everything in March.
Yeah.
And you mentioned that you were DJ, right? Do you think this knowledge about music, your passion about music, brought something for the photographer, for things that you take for now? Or?
Yeah, I used to think about them both in similar ways. So in music production, you've got a studio, you've got obviously a screen, your keyboard or synthesizer is what they call it, uh-huh. and you've got two monitors. And the monitors, they're not like normal speakers, they're called just monitors. They've got true sound. I think you might guys maybe have some here as well. So that's giving you a true representation of the sound that you're trying to work with, which to me, I translate it to a RAW file. In music, they call it WAV, or WAV, W-A-V. Uh-huh. And then once you've put your initial idea down, which is still RAW, RAW kick drum, RAW melody, raw hi-hat, it's all raw, it's all original sound. Then you've got to add effects to it like reverb, delay, EQing. And they had similar things in like the tone curve, and then the basics panel, which I transferred that off. It was a similar process. You're taking something from its raw state and trying to make it alive. You're bringing it alive. You can't make a raw music without putting effects on it. It's going to sound like it's come out of a computer. And so yeah, that's transferred over.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
It's and the way that you're talking about it looks like you're having like layers on Photoshop or doing stuff on the photo, bring the raw and doing different things.
Trying to make it come to life, trying to take people through, and keep them in the picture as well. Because you know when you listen to a music and it's got a catchy hook, a hook, you want to play it again. If you're in the car on your own, I'm gonna put it back again.
You said something that I really love it, which is how we can hook people, right?
Yeah.
What do you try to pretty much like show with your pictures to the people?
Yeah. In a nutshell, I'm trying to get them to see like the scene, how I saw it at the place. Mm. It's really hard to take a picture and to show people what it was like as a human. Coming through the human eye, because the human eye can see much more detail, and you're trying to keep them there, and the moment as well. What's happening? What are the people doing? Every little detail matters. The footstep, how they're carrying an umbrella, where the umbrella is, as they walk. Are they putting the umbrella up? Are they doing something? And a combination between the actions of people or the environment. Coupled with lighting is how I try to get people in. I try to keep them in the scene, try to keep it. It was an art concept where the artist said, when you're doing art, you've got to keep people in a circle. If people leave that circle, they're going to go out of the picture.
That's true.
So if you've got a leading line, it's fine to have a leading line that's going out of the picture, but you've got to maybe darken it a little bit. Otherwise, people are going to go.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
I like the way that you put this interpretation on the photo.
Yeah, yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So that's the way that you think people catch the people and make them interest in your photos.
Yeah, catch them, kidnap them, bring them into the picture.
We talk a little bit and it looks like you are really always worried about the composition, right?
Yeah.
And even here we are touching a few things. Why do you think composition is important for photography?
Because it definitely makes or breaks an image. It's so important to have a unique composition where people have never seen the usual in an unusual way. If you go to a new city, everything's brand new. It's so exciting. You can see things differently than a local person. But once you live in the same city and you go to the same spot, it's so hard to unsee what everybody's seen. And that's why composition is so important, and practicing composition, shapes, lines, lighting, color, that's really important in the composition, to be different. It's one thing going to take a picture of the same spot, but it's another thing to do it in a totally different way.
And when you talk about composition, also your artistic side, right? Do you, because you said that you were a DJ, do you still being a DJ or you still play music?
No. My friend, he's got some DJIs, I think. Sometimes he throws a party and he gets me on and I go on. But I've got tinnitus in my ears. So that's the ringing noise.
Oh.
And I got that when I was 22, and the doctor said, if you don't stop DJing now, you're going to be deaf by the time you're 40. Oh,
so you have like this noise, constant noise all the time?
Yeah. It's fine if unless you realize that it's there again.
Okay.
So people can forget about tinnitus, distracted from it. Mm-hmm. But the moment you go, I've got tinnitus, then
you remember everything.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the same like, you don't need to think about a pink elephant.
Yeah, yeah. Don't think about the pink elephant.
So if DJ is not your thing anymore, what you do, you have any other like hobby that you could use to bring this passion or this composition or things that you believe it's important for you to be an artist?
Not really. Not anything now that I do. I do mainly photography.
Okay.
But I do draw on my previous years. I was crazy into the gym when I was younger. I trained for like 14 years, a long time. And sometimes you need that discipline in photography.
Gotcha.
And the fact that I was trained four to six times a week, it really helped. Like, because sometimes you don't want to do it, right? You're like, oh my God, do I have to go out there and take some pictures? I'm so tired. But if you want to become really good at something, which I do personally, for me, if I'm going to do something, it's all or nothing. So I'm not going to go into it for a personal endeavor. I'm just going to do everything. I'm just going to go for it. I'm going to put a lot of energy into it. And so using things like weight training, it was just weight training at the gym, cycling, using that, as well as, you know, DJing and all that sort of stuff. I draw on that.
Looking your website, because you have to do like a little bit of research before I talk with you, right? And that what caught my attention was the philosophy that you have. And what do you think this philosophy that we need to put this on the video so everyone can read as well.
Sure.
But what do you think this philosophy is important for you?
You have to keep going back to it. To understand why you're even doing photography, or why you're trying so hard in the difficult times to do it. Why am I doing this? What's the point? You know, these questions pop up when you're doing it on your own. Like you said, it can be a bit lonely. It's a lonely endeavor as photography. So when you're on your own, you think about things, and these questions pop up. They're almost like existential questions. What's the point in doing this?
It's true.
Yeah, and if you do it too much, I find that creeps in. If I shoot every day and it becomes not fun, these existential questions start popping in.
Yeah.
And then I use the philosophy of and what I like to do to get me through it.
Cool. Bringing back like 2017, right? March of 2017, you said that you... Let's grab the camera again.
Yeah, yeah.
So what's happened after that?
A lot of work, a lot of bad images. And my girlfriend even said to me at one point, she went, you're a photo junkie, because I was just posting every day on Instagram. So I was learning a lot of stuff, researching, shooting, coming up with ideas. You know, they're exciting at the time. To look back, they weren't that great.
Okay.
But I didn't know anything then, so they were exciting to me. Even the smallest of ideas, oh, I've got an idea. I even went out into my garden to take a picture of my tattoo and a flower. I thought it's going to be a great idea.
But that's a good point, because I think more and more, I believe people use social medias not to please themselves, but to show something to other people, right? And the way that you're saying, you use the social media, but you are happy what we are doing, despite the fact now you have more knowledge, you have more skills, you know that could be better, but that time you were happy. Do you think people are missing these, or they only use social medias just to please other people instead of to please themselves?
Definitely a good question. I think I also do that myself. I also have to catch myself out when I'm editing and I'm rushing my edit. I think, I'll post this tonight, and then I think, no, wait, just slow down a little bit. I think that is in everybody. I don't think anybody can escape that. I think social media is social media, and it's just brought out the human aspect of people and what people are really like. We all want people to notice us, but at the same time, we don't, I guess, in a weird way. People are their own master, and you have to learn that. And I think social media can teach you or not.
it's so hard, right? And I think... Saying that, thinking what you said, if you take pictures every day, sometimes it's not fun anymore.
Yeah.
And you have to think about it and start to be automatic.
Yeah.
And I think we passed this moment as well recently.
Mm-hmm.
Why I have to post?
Yeah.
Why I have to shoot again?
Yeah.
Oh, what I'm doing?
Yeah. Yeah.
So do you have like these moments as well, right?
Sure.
Even though that after you being a professional photographer,
sure,
doing stuff,
yeah,
do you have moments that you say, why I have to do this?
Yeah, yes. Well, yeah, I do. Yeah. It's not a good feeling either, is it? Yeah.
And what are the things that you say, okay, cool, that's just a moment, let's
yeah,
overcome that and let's
yeah,
push to do something different. What keeps you motivated?
What keeps me motivated? First of all, I need to recognize it and stop and just take a rest, because sometimes that's all it is. You're tired,
uh-huh,
you've done too much. You need to let what you've done sink in and go through you and pass out and leave you.
Uh-huh.
And then the new knowledge of what you've learned or what you've not learned, but the experience that you've learned, you can go again. And sometimes you do have to wait. You have to wait to feel that I'm going to go out and shoot. Now it feels fun. And I feel like it's always this seesaw where you're trying to balance it out, where you're not trying to go too hard,
uh-huh,
because you need to leave room for it to be exciting. And if you go too much, the excitement seems to go. But the paradox with photography is it's so much fun when it's fun. So you want to keep going and keep going. And then you hit a point where you're like, oh, damn, I'm there again.
So Anton, you look like there you have like a lot of experience and work in different situations, different clients. Can you tell me like a fun situation or situation that stress you out and you say, oh my God, then I'm not going to do this anymore?
It's sometimes saying yes to work that I have no idea what I'm doing. I really push back against the fact that. So I do real estate photography,
uh-huh,
and they try to get me to do portrait stuff. And I don't look forward to it. I get imposter syndrome big time, because when you go to take someone's picture, they're expecting, I'd never done portrait stuff,
uh-huh,
but the company that I work for didn't ever ask me, and they just sent me on shoots. And the people, when you go there, they're expecting you to pose them, they're expecting you to make them look good, and they're expecting you to tell them where to put their hand and all this, and that's not fun for me.
Oh.
The expectation level from them transferred over to me is stressful.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So what you're saying basically is, despite the fact that you are a really good photographer, a landscape photographer, a real estate photographer, for you to do like a portrait, you have to have a different skills.
Yes.
So it's something that people need to understand that as well. Despite the fact that you know how to take a picture, it doesn't mean that you can take a picture for everything.
Sure, yeah. Like sports.
Oh, really?
If you play football, doesn't mean you can play tennis.
There we go.
To the same degree that a tennis player plays tennis.
There we go. And yeah, what do you think is difficult for you to take pictures of people?
Because I'm not trained to
okay,
do it. I've got no interest. I've got interest in shooting people,
okay,
but not to portrait stuff, making them,
uh-huh,
making them look nice. I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in candid, raw people. What are they doing when they don't see me shooting,
uh-huh,
them, which sounds kind of weird, but that's really going back to the question you asked me before about how do I draw people in. I love to catch those intimate moments that,
mm-hmm,
people don't know you're looking. Maybe they do something, they, I don't know, they're picking
it's,
something
it's
up
hard, yeah,
yeah, I posted an image on my story and I was at Fremantle, the memorial,
uh-huh,
and there was a woman walking around and she had a walking stick. And I got a moment where her hand's just coming through a pillow and you can just see a walking stick. And I was really happy with that shot. Although I didn't post it because I don't think it's going to be received well on my page, which is another weird thing about posting on Instagram. It was a really good image that I like.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
But that's the thing. If you like, why do you think it's important other people's opinion?
What I've learned, it's better to please your audience than
okay,
push them away. This is a question that I always ask myself as well. And I've tried it over time and things don't do well. And then when they don't do well, you don't want to jeopardize the effort that you've put into your page.
Mm,
you want to keep...
That's a good point.
Yeah, you want to keep your audience happy. And there's definitely people out there who say, no, that's not the right thing to do. And then there's people that is. I'm conflicted about that. Sometimes I do. It's took me a long time to incorporate street into my feed where it looks good and it looks cohesive. But I do agree with some people that it can spoil your feed if you put the wrong stuff in. And I'm a perfectionist, so I want it to look good.
And talking about a little bit of, because both of us here, Frank and I, we did a little bit of, Frank is still doing, I don't do this anymore. I'm not saying that I'm not drinking from this water, it's just different things that I'm doing now. And we did a little bit of real estate. And mainly you do this real estate on the ground, or you use drone as well?
Yeah, drone, yeah.
Use both?
Yeah.
Okay. What are the main challenges or things that you say that if I could come back 3 years or 4 years ago, what I could be doing different that I don't need to do the same mistakes before?
In real estate?
Yeah.
Well, I've been in real estate a year and a half, so I don't have that much experience yet.
1.5 years is a lot.
Yeah, yeah. See, yeah. When you're shooting houses. Yeah, it's a lot of houses. So if I'm going to go back to the beginning when I first started, I would definitely say don't worry too much. Real estate's not that difficult to get in to start with.
Okay.
It's mainly lines. Get your lines straight and your angles. There's people out there who will teach you how to do that. And then the next thing is just being efficient. I think that's just business minded anyway. Just being efficient with everything. So when you go to a house, the agents don't want every shot.
Okay.
Sometimes they don't tell you which shots they want. There's some obviously standard shots, but I had one agent who I work for regularly, and he told me, you know, he said, "Oh, you're just doing too many shots. Stop taking too many shots." So then I had to rethink what are the best shots, because they want only the best shots.
Gotcha.
Some agents don't care; they'll chuck the images away. But some agents only want the best ones. Yeah.
So lines are important for real estate. What would be the other technique that you use to make your photos stand out from the competition, for example?
Definitely,
for real estate.
Yeah, definitely composition.
Okay.
Most rooms are going to be wide angle because they want this is real estate for the not interior design, but real estate. So interior design is more artistic, where real estate is for selling a house. But there's still an element of the artistic process in that. But really what they want, the main thing is the wide rooms, make the rooms look big. So you got a 16 millimeter minimum. Some want a 14.
Okay.
And then you got to get make sure your lines are straight. So that's straightening your camera. Every cameras or new cameras have got an internal level. And you got to make sure the lines are straight. They're always going to be distorted.
Gotcha.
You can fix that in post. Unless you have a tilt shift lens, which can measure it. And then you've got to learn how to do detailed shots.
What do you mean?
So you'll pick the nicest part of the house or the building or the internal contents and zoom in on that. So the outside might have a really nice front door with a nice walkway in there with some nice vegetation outside. So instead of always doing wide shots, you need to learn how to zoom in and get the detailed shots. Use your aperture to get some shallow depth of field. And just stand out a little bit. Definitely composition. Two people can go in the same room and shoot a different image. And it depends how the room's laid out. So if the room's laid out, you know, and it's got different compartments to the room, then you have to be a bit more attentive to what you're shooting. If you're just going into one bedroom, but that's just one bedroom, then that's just a door shot, and then you've got the...
It's hard.
Yeah.
But when you say wide angles and you have like a different to get the details, is there any way, or sometimes you have like a wide shot, but they realize when you are doing like your post-production, you could crop here with looking good and you can just crop and you'll be okay?
Sure. The funny thing about that is that I don't actually edit my images, so I don't look at them.
Oh, okay.
But however, I want to start my own thing up eventually. So I've started the process now, which is why I bought the new Mac, of editing images. And now I can see what I'm doing wrong. Even more. I do look at them on the back of the camera, but it's different to putting it on your screen, and you can actually look and you go, oh, that doesn't look nice. You know, so yeah.
General like wide angles, especially on homes inside or for real estate, are good. And we know sometimes even the widest angle, we cannot capture everything.
Sure.
Do you need to use like different images to compose one image, or?
I've never done that.
Mm-hmm.
If I can't get something, so I say you look into a room, and then you've got the window there, and then you've got the bathroom there. Take two shots, so you'll take one facing that way. And then you'll go in the opposite end in a diagonal line, turn around, and then you'll shoot that way because you want to capture the door to the ensuite and the walk-in wardrobe. Mm-hmm. Or you can do a straight shot. So you can do different shots in the same room.
Uh-huh.
For example, if you've got a really tiny dining room in between a living room and a kitchen, then you can shoot in a couple of different ways to give people context. Like, where is it near? Is it near the kitchen? Is it near the living room? And you can take several shots so people know, oh, that room is in between the kitchen and the living room.
And I know all the time that we see like some photos from real estate, not all the composition are the way that you're saying.
Sure.
And what is the technique that you have to use? For example, I saw so many pictures that they took amazing pictures inside, but outside could have like a garden, could have like a beautiful tree.
Sure.
What are the techniques that you use to capture both, the best of both, inside or outside?
Again, it's there's not that many rules to capture the best.
Uh-huh.
There's a lot of straight shots, so you want to catch the money shot is different at every house.
Yeah.
So sometimes the garden's not that great. So you've got to miss certain parts of the house out to make it look good. Which, as a creative, it's sometimes a difficult thing to do, right? Some people refer to it as called cutting the fat. Uh-huh. I know writers have referred to it that way, or movie producers or directors, but you've got to look at something and say, that doesn't work, I'm going to cut that out, and then just get the best angle.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Sometimes, you know, you're like, I'm going to shoot that, but there's a lot of rubbish at the side. And when people come, they're going to go, oh, what's that doing there? But you just miss out the rubbish and you take the best shot.
And you said to me that sometimes you have like 8 different houses per day, right?
Yes.
How is your... Tell me a little bit how you can plan your day and how you can shoot. What's happening in your day every day?
Okay, so the company that I work for, they have an admin team and they arrange all the shoots.
Uh-huh.
They put it in a calendar, which is an app that we all use together. And I can look at that, I can see what time the shoot is, who it's with, what type of shoot it is, the different jobs on that shoot. So it might be a sales shoot, drone shots, video, which regularly happens up in Bedford Dale for me. And you just make sure you turn up at the job.
Oh, so you have to do video as well?
Yeah, I do video as well. Yeah, videography. Yeah.
Oh,
which I'm not.
That's the next level.
I'm not a big fan of.
Yeah. But you don't. You said that you take the pictures.
Yeah.
Even the video, you don't need to edit.
No.
If you don't edit your photos, if you don't edit your videos, sometimes you forget how good you are, or if there's points that you need to improve.
Yeah.
So that's why you said that you bought a new computer just to see.
Yeah.
So you are taking time to look in your footage, your photos?
Yeah, I'm taking time to look at them and I'm editing them as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I want... The thing to do now is you can take... If I have my own company, I can shoot the images, but you can send them off anyway. There's companies out there that just do editing and they'll charge $1 or $2 per image. So if you've got 30 images, it's going to cost you an extra $60, but that means you can shoot more and send your images off.
You'll free up your time.
Free up your time, yeah. But my logical thinking is that there's going to be some AI. There is already AI out there that helps you edit your images. I don't know if it's at the level where real estate is at the minute, but my plan is to edit in such a way that I can use AI to help me so I don't have to outsource the work. So there's one called Imagine AI. I don't know if you've heard of it.
No.
So basically, Imagine AI will take your Lightroom catalog, and it's going to take like 3,000 to 5,000 images, they say, and then that's going to read your settings, your parameters, and then you can put images in there, and it'll give them you back. I've already put 30 images in, it gave them me back in 10 seconds.
Are you kidding me?
No, that was based off somebody else's profile, but I just wanted to see how quickly it would do it.
Jesus Christ.
I don't know if it's going to work with real estate because, especially HDR, blending images. But I want to get to the point where I can send them a HDR file, they can do some basic edits, and then I can come in and mask out windows and bring the windows back. So at the minute, I'm training my Lightroom catalog in a way that I like to my specific standard. And that's also taking time because, you know, colouring, it's so...
It takes time, yeah.
Even the same room, the same house, different image is slightly different. Somehow I don't get it.
Different monitors, everything.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's say that people that are listening to this podcast, they don't know much about the techniques or the terminology that we are talking about. You mentioned like HDR. Explain a little bit more for me what is a HDR.
HDR means high dynamic range, and what that's referring to is the shadows, the mids and the highlights in an image. Your camera, unlike your eye, can only see something. So if you want to see something bright, then the shadow areas are going to be dark, and so you can only expose for highlights or shadows. So to get the full range of shadows, mids and highs, you need to take three separate shots. You need to take a shot for the shadows, a shot for the mid, and a shot for the highlights. And then you blend them together, and then you've got the full range of dynamic range.
Okay, cool. I told you someone is going to learn something today. And you said that you start to use drones as well. What? How come did you start to use drones? Was a necessity? Someone asking for you?
No, I just like the perspective of a drone. It's just, for me, it's having another lens, basically. Yeah, another perspective.
So, which one you prefer? Drones or ground?
Depends on the situation. I definitely use my camera more, my Nikon. I'm a Nikon user. I use my Nikon more than my drone. I feel drones are more suited for big mountain landscapes. They look really good. You know, not really good for cities. You can get some good city shots if you're outside. Cityscapes are good, but not street. You wouldn't use a drone for a street. And I don't use it that much in real estate either. People in real estate want it for just so you do a bird's eye view or a top down image of a property, and then they'll just outline the size of it. Yeah, and then the other shot is really just having the house in the bottom corner of a shot when it's in its normal perspective, and then you'll put points of interest.
Gotcha.
So I don't know, activity, leisure center, gym,
shopping center,
yeah. Park, all that stuff. Yeah.
Oh, cool. What's your favorite place to shoot here in Perth?
They've all stopped becoming my favorite because I've been to them all, but I love Hyde Park. Hyde Park is, I really like going there. I actually went there recently, but it's quite small. So I think I'm almost out of ideas at Hyde Park.
And it's small, but the photos that you take from that is unbelievable.
It's probably my best photos are from Hyde Park, I'd say.
So what you have to do, you have to wait. You have to hide yourself, then Hyde Park, you have to hide yourself.
Camouflage.
Because some photos, I think, the eye that you use, and I think you said that you like cold weather.
Yeah.
Do you think winter is the best time to shoot there?
I think so, yeah. I think right now, but we're in April, April, May, when there are prescribed fire burns, if they reach the city, are good. I think any kind of smoke, fog that diffuses too much detail, a lot of detail in the background, is always good for an image.
Okay.
For me, having a clean image without clutter or distraction is really important. So on one of my most popular images, which is a lady riding a bicycle through Hyde Park, it was smoky on that day. So it's hiding all the clutter in the background.
Gosh.
There's a couple of buildings there. There's a lot of trees, but it's just diffusing it to the point where the details aren't in your face.
Uh-huh.
And so you can take a journey through the image. You can end up the cyclist, but you only see the cyclist because she's not in the smoke. She's kind of in the smoke.
But yeah. Nowadays is the best time for you then.
Yeah. Yeah.
We have smoke every day.
Yeah. You're having it too. I live just below the hills.
Uh-huh.
So my house stinks of smoke.
Really?
Yeah, I can't put my laundry outside.
Jesus. I remember, I think it was last year, I was commissioned to shoot for City of Perth, and one of the places that they asked for me to shoot was King's Park.
Sure.
And I had to take the photos before sunrise. I was there really early in the morning. I arrived there in King's Park, I was on the top, so I used this time to shoot some night shots.
Sure.
And I could see the smoke coming.
Oh yeah.
And after, man, everything was covered.
Yeah. Smoke or
smoke.
Fog.
Smoke.
Yeah.
Smoke.
Yeah.
Is this basically this time of the year?
Yeah, that's
it's
right.
It's crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's the favorite time for you.
Yeah.
Winter and smoke.
Yeah, yeah. The smoky place.
Have some forest.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, they're all Yeah, they're all foggy apart from the last one that you just did. Yeah.
From all these photos that Franco is showing you, of course, you're going to put here for you guys to see as well. Which one do you prefer? What is your favorite photo?
That's my favorite photo.
Hard, hey?
Yeah. I want to say the Hyde Park one with the cyclist, but it's not. I think it's one in Fremantle that was on there, what he showed a minute ago, and it's got two people fishing, and the composition satisfies my like little obsession with triangles in composition. I like triangles in composition. I like shapes in my compositions.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they're not that obvious, but triangles is one of them. And the sun setting behind the lighthouse, behind a big cargo boat, and two people are fishing, and you can see the fishing line, and you can see them both.
Really?
Yeah, I think that's probably my favorite image. Or there's another one where there's one person walking in front of the city. That's on another smoky smoky day, and it's just one person. And it's the image is just, it's muted tones, I guess. Just a blue and black, really, yeah.
Amazing, man. Yeah. And you mentioned that your partner is from Japan, right?
Yes.
And I've seen your work, and I saw that you shot in different places around the world as well. What is your favorite place that you could shoot and say, oh, that's an amazing place to go as well to shoot?
In Japan or anywhere?
It could be anywhere, that some place that gives you this inspiration, this desire, I'm going to be shooting, I'm going to be filming, or do something here.
Yeah, I'd say Japan.
Japan.
Yeah. There's so much stuff in Japan, it's ridiculous. There's one place that I went in Japan, it's called Shirakawago.
Uh-huh.
And it took me 4 hours to get there, 5 hours. It's near Kanazawa. So I rented a car in Kanazawa, stayed in Kanazawa.
Mm-hmm.
And you drive through the mountains.
No way.
And it's got the hairpin roads everywhere.
Oh.
On the way is a big waterfall called Tedori Gorge. And then you keep going, you go to the top, it's all misty, and then you come back down into this traditional village, and it's all pointy houses with straw, big houses as well, not small. Yeah, beautiful in the valley of the mountains.
That's incredible. Yeah. Did you have opportunity when you went there to stay in accommodation there, like really typical Japanese accommodation?
I've stayed in typical Japanese accommodation with my girlfriend before.
Really?
Yeah.
How was that?
A little bit uncomfortable.
I thought he was going to say amazing, most unique experience or something, but no.
she booked us this small room. It was definitely a good experience.
Yeah.
It was on a futon, so I was pretty uncomfortable. It was really small. But yeah.
Everything there is small.
Yeah.
But they have two, right?
Yeah. If I'm going to say something really good about Japan, outside of the accommodation, it's you can go to Japan, you can get off the train, and you can walk into a bar and down some small steps with about three people inside in winter when it's you'd never experience winter, right?
Not there.
Right. So in winter, going into a warm place is like, you know, you want to go into a warm place. And it's just a small bar with a couple of people there. They serve beer. And then they'll put on this shabba shabba. Mm-hmm. So it's basically you boil water and you dip in these slices of meat. So you can have a meal there at the same time.
Almost like a soup.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then after they'll put noodles in, mix it up and you'll eat.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So yeah. It's a small, intimate, cozy bars in winter that I really loved about Japan.
I feel so frustrated. Hey? Yeah. Do you know that I'm half Japanese?
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's common.
Matsumoto.
Matsumoto.
Oh, yeah, yeah, right.
I didn't know about anything that you said.
Do you know any Japanese?
Matsumoto.
Because it's common for Japanese people to live in Brazil, I heard.
Yeah, yeah. I think, well, at least so far as I know, outside of Japan, the biggest colony, Japanese colonies in Brazil.
Wow.
In São Paulo, the place that I came.
And how did it become to be in Brazil?
I guess, I'm not 100% sure about that. I think it was because of the war.
Second World War.
Yeah, and after Brazil, I think, was the safest place for them to go.
Sure.
If they were not in US, they could go Brazil. And there is only one suburb there in Brazil that's all typical Japanese.
Really?
It's amazing. You can go every Sunday, eat Japanese food on the streets.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's incredible.
Wow.
Incredible.
But so you're half Japanese?
I'm half Japanese, but I have no idea about anything. The contact that I have with my Japanese part is really, really small. I don't know that. Completely.
Yeah,
like, okay. But I know that there is like a city with my name, my surname. And I went there, I don't know, almost 10 years ago.
You've been to Japan?
Yeah, yeah, I've been there. My brother, he used to work for Toyota. Mm-hmm. And he went to Japan to learn Japanese.
Right, okay.
So he was 1 year over there. And I used this time to go there and visit him.
Wow.
Yeah. And after travel around.
Yeah, yeah.
Shinkansen and travel everywhere.
It's beautiful, isn't it?
It's, man, that place is unbelievable.
Yeah, yeah.
If people want to visit something completely different, Japan is the place to go.
And it's so nice as well.
Ah, it's beautiful. I think even people are so polite.
Yeah.
Polite that sometimes is annoying.
Yeah.
In a good way. Right.
I wanted to bring that up actually. Sometimes when you go into a store, they say thank you, so you say thank you, and they say it, and then you say
they keep saying.
Before you know it, you're both bowing.
But the other thing that's annoying me is my wife. She talked with me, and she's after we went there, she said, "You have so many things from Japan, that from Japanese people, culture.
Yeah.
I can't believe that you've never been close to them." I said, I don't know, maybe it's in the blood.
What kind of things are they?
Like the things that I do, the way that I behave.
Yeah.
I'm always polite, right, Frank?
Really polite, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't say bad words, so.
That's definitely a Japanese thing, to be polite. I mean, we're all polite, but they're on another level.
Yeah.
Polite and kind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable. I love that place, and I can't wait to come back there.
Sure, sure.
It's the place.
My girlfriend, she's the most thoughtful person I've ever met.
Uh-huh.
When I go on, I'll go Stirling Ranges or down to Esperance, and she'll pack me a bag full of, or a box full of treats.
Really?
And on the treats, she leaves little sticky notes. Come back safe, don't be doing anything. No Abenai. Abenai means danger. No Abenai places, yeah. Because she knows I go up to both know, and I'm close to the edge, and she gets worried.
Yeah.
So she's very thoughtful. She'll pack me up all the stuff. I don't even know about it, and then it's got all these notes in. Yeah.
Where did you meet her? Sorry.
Oh, sorry. Met in Perth here.
Oh, here.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, cool. So yeah. she came to do like study here. What she's doing here?
She just came to working holiday.
Oh.
Yeah, for 2 years. We met here, and we've been together now since 2015.
Oh, wow.
8 years. Yeah, 8 years. We're saving up for a house now.
That's amazing, man.
Yeah, I've been back twice to see her family. They're so nice. I mean, her sister is where we spent most of the time. They've got four kids.
Four kids in Japan?
In a two-bedroomed apartment, and they wouldn't let me pay for anything. They pay for everything. Not everything, because I wasn't with them the whole time, but anytime we went out, they paid for the meals.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
And it's better to let them, otherwise you're going to be disrespectful.
Yeah,
something like that.
Yeah, I made them jacket potato, which is for me, it's a typical English English meal. So, was it jacket potato or shepherd's pie? Maybe shepherd's pie.
They want to please you.
I wanted to please them. I made it for them.
Oh,
yeah,
really?
Yeah, as a return, because they wouldn't let me pay. It wasn't annoying. I just go, I'll pay. And they go, no, don't worry about it. in the Japanese, you know.
But man, four people there and everything is so small.
Yeah, yeah, super small.
I can't. My brother has two kids, and it was already like a small place to live in.
Yeah, yeah. He still lives there, does he?
No. He come back to Brazil. He stayed there in Brazil. He left Toyota. Toyota hired him again, and now he's in Belgium.
Belgium.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
He's living there now.
How's he like Belgium?
Good question. I need to talk to him.
Yeah.
He moved at the end of the year in December. And since then, I didn't talk with him.
Now he knows the cold. Shame, hey. He knows the cold from Japan as well.
My sister-in-law is complaining a lot.
Yeah.
But they have like the cold weather as well in Japan.
Sure.
So it was the place that they used to live, have like snow. So for them, it's no, it's strange.
Yeah, yeah.
And
she
said, I could use the clothes that we bought in Japan here. So it was good to them.
Making good use.
Yeah, they are happy there, man. It's better. Any place, I think, outside of Brazil nowadays is good.
Yeah, okay. Is that the general thinking of people? So people who move from Brazil to Australia or emigrate anywhere, do they generally want to go home because they miss it, or do they want to stay in the country that they moved to?
I think when you talk about Brazil, we, as a family, we always are trying to be together.
Sure.
So I think we miss this
connection
and have people around and parties.
Sure.
We love to parties, barbecues, everything. So that's something that we always love and we miss here. When we come here, unless you have like friends or Brazilian friends or people that have the same culture that is here, it's a little bit hard.
Of course,
Australians, they have their own culture.
Sure.
Other people around here, they have their own culture. So it's hard sometimes for you.
Yeah, you realize once you've been here, even being English, it's different.
Yeah.
It's closer than most people or everybody else. I think we're the closest, but it's still different. We have different, we call it banter. The banter's different. I miss the banter with my lifelong friends back in the UK, but there's not much in the UK keeping me there. It's a bit much harder to live, much harder to save, so much harder to save. But you're right when you say different cultures. Everybody stays with the same culture.
Yeah.
Even in the same area, if there's Indian people living in one area, they'll all move there. If there's Chinese people, they'll all move there.
Brazilians, they all go to Scarborough.
Yeah. they're always at the night markets there. Because of the beach, right?
the climate, I think everything, the culture, all the people are there.
Yeah.
It's funny. I don't know why.
Sure.
But they always, they're all together there.
Yeah.
Which is good. Anton, what would be your, just change a little bit of the subject.
Yeah.
Just coming back, because I remember this question. What would be your advice for someone that's starting in photography today?
If you're going to start in photography, take it slow and let the concepts sink in. and really figure out some good practice routines. So going out and just taking pictures is not really a good practice routine, in my opinion. I think you need techniques on how to practice. For example, you can go out and just practice shooting shapes. Look for shapes, shoot shapes. I like triangles. Like I said before, I like to shoot triangles. The object of shooting different things, whether they're abstract, minimal, is so that when you do go out and you want, eventually when you go out and take pictures, these things come back quickly. If you're just going out taking pictures and you're not really focusing on composition or different techniques of to create a good composition, then you're going to feel disappointed quickly. You're going to come out with some images that you don't progress much with over 6 months or so.
Okay. Yeah. And I remember at the beginning that we were talking, you said that you used to go like often sunrise, go to the place and try to go take pictures every day. What do you think? What do you think that's important for photographers to go in different place or try to shoot every day? Why do you think this is important for a photographer or a professional?
Yeah, it's important because you want to ingrain habits, like a recall system in your mind. You need that recall, you need that practice. You'll probably often hear that, you know, out of 1,000 images, you might get a good one. I don't know if it's 100 images or 1,000,000. Some other people say different things, but basically, it's hard to get sometimes even one really, really good image that you're proud of. So you have to put the repetition in and you have to go out and practice these things over and over again. So when you do see something specific, let's say example, street photography, that can pass in a minute, you need to recall on all these techniques very quickly. And that doesn't just include composition, it includes the technical aspect of the camera focus. Which focus do you want? Quickly changing settings, what's the best way for you to change a setting?
Gotcha. Yeah. So the way that you see the same probably will be basically when you drive. So the more you drive, the easiest you'll be for you to change your things, indicator, everything. So you'll be the same with the camera.
You just, so the camera is in the way of taking a picture, basically, even though it does take a picture. So you want that to become second nature. So when you do see the picture in your mind, it's, you can catch it quicker.
Fantastic. So persevere, know your equipment, test, train, go take pictures all the time.
Yeah.
Those are really good advice. Is there, because more and more, for example, you take a lot of pictures, and what would be your advice for people that are taking these pictures and, okay, what I can do with that?
Okay.
What would be your advice to them?
As in terms of maybe putting it on social media or doing something with the actual images?
I don't know. What do you want to, what would like to say?
So let's say you take a bunch of pictures and you edit them and they just sat there. Obviously, the first thing is to put them on social media, which is Instagram, but I feel like Instagram's super oversaturated and it's not the best way to start out with photography because you can go on there and feel disappointed when nobody cares because the because the algorithm supports consistency.
Gotcha.
I just wanted to put it out there because it's not the be all and end all of photography. Instagram is there for a good reason, but it's just a tool. You can put them on a calendar. You can make a series. You can say, right, I'm going to go out and I'm going to shoot some shapes. I'm going to see what I come up with. And you can put them into a little project. I think it's important to try and keep the motivation for photography alive by liking what you shoot and being proud of what you shoot. If you're just shooting because you want to show people what you've done, then that leads to you just putting things out there that you don't necessarily want to put out there. And so if you're proud of something you've shot, then you're more likely to do something unique with it.
Okay.
Yeah, you can put it into a project. You can make a media kit and send that off. If you can find the contacts and try and get work from that. I did that with real estate. I shot a few houses with a friend who's a builder. and then I put them together, and then I sent them off to a company and I got a job. So you can get work as well.
That's amazing. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a good tip, man.
Yeah.
I hope everyone is listening and can use that, because I realize we were talking about that our photography world is kind of lonely, right?
Yeah.
And more and more sometimes you have to have not tapping in your back, but at least realize that we struggle a lot.
Yeah.
It's not all
sure
good things that happen with us.
Yeah.
And that's important people to understand that you have to persevere, you have to learn, and you have to go out and raining,
yes,
sun, sunrise, sunset, do everything.
Sure.
Franco, do you have any questions for our friend?
I have so many.
There we go.
Now, I like the emotional approach that Rodrigo take, but I think many people is really interested about your, I don't know, your kind of technical stuff, right?
Sure.
Talking about the gear, you mentioned that you are using Nikon, which the market is oversaturated with Sony and Canon.
Yeah.
Why do you choose Nikon?
There's no specific reason why I chose Nikon. I just went for a brand that was popular because it's everybody uses it, so you can be confident in that.
Yeah.
And that's the way I went. I just chose Nikon, not for any specific reason. I don't think people need to think about choosing at the beginning.
Yeah.
They don't need to think about choosing a camera too much.
Oh, okay, that's good.
Also, don't invest your whole money into a camera system or a brand, because you may want to change after you become better.
That's a good point.
Yeah, yes.
That's a good point.
Yeah. So at the beginning...
That never changed with us. Never happened.
So, same with me. That actually happened to me. So I just go with Nikon now. I know my lenses are Nikon, and I'm thinking about switching to some... That's better with automatic, with focus, which I think is Sony.
Yeah.
And now I'm stuck with Nikon, and I've got some good lenses with Nikon, and they're expensive lenses, and I can't afford to change.
They're always adapters, hey?
Yeah. And the other thing with Nikon is not many third-party lens brands are making the new Z-mount.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so I've got an adapter, and I've not got no Z-mounts, but I've got a Z camera.
Uh-huh.
And the Z mount lenses are so expensive.
Oh, they are really.
Yeah, yeah. I do believe that Nikon has got the best color science, and I'm saying that loosely because I don't even know what color science is.
That's a good point.
Yeah, but that's what people say, and that's what I've read. So apparently, the most truest colors.
Okay.
Yeah, and you can tell them on skin tones. That's the telling sign. Mm. Yeah, don't overthink the camera stuff. I did. I overthought it, and it took me ages to buy a camera. You don't need to. You just buy the cheapest camera with a kit lens that's versatile, and then go and shoot and see what you like.
How about the phones nowadays?
Yeah, the phone's good. You can start on your phone. That's a great idea. Yeah, yeah. I agree. Yeah, start on your phone.
And you can shoot in RAW in phone.
Yeah, yeah, you can shoot in RAW.
That's crazy.
And then use the light as well. Use your light when you're shooting, especially on a phone, because the phone's not the same as a camera. They're amazing, but they're not the same quality. So using light is really good with a phone, if you can use light, shadows and light.
Another question that came to my mind was pretty interesting, because it's talking about your specific style. I know that you talk about composition and all the you know, your knowledge that you had to put in every single photo, and every photo is different, every photo maybe takes, you need to use different lenses as well.
Sure.
But is something that we can see, or at least in your last year, that although your photos is kind of the same stylish, if you can maybe put in words what we can see now for someone which is blind, for example, how you can describe your photos? Do you use high contrast in your post-production? Do you choose maybe shoot people, the subject needs to be far away, which is the element that you pretty much repeat every time, or try to repeat, or maybe it's really, really stick with your stylish?
Sure. It definitely, there's a lot of it is in the editing, but it starts in the camera as well. So I'm always thinking about, if I'm putting people in, I'm thinking about distance.
Yeah.
So, and it depends what lens I'm using.
Mm-hmm.
I can use a zoom lens, but I need to be further away.
I do use a wide angle, so 16 to 35, 24 to 70, 70 to 200, 200 to 500. So Jesus. I've got all the range.
Jesus.
Yeah. So if I want to keep my feet consistent but get a slightly different look, I have to think about distance with those lenses. Obviously, I can't go down shooting a foreground with a 500 millimeter.
Yes.
And then the editing is important, because if you have a consistent editing, the way you edit, then that's going to make your images look consistent, and that using color, contrast, fade, lighting, that all helps. Yeah.
So masks everywhere.
Masking, yeah.
What I can see in your photos is kind of this kind of custom vignetting that you create. Like, it's everything dark on the side,
sure.
And the focus is almost every time in the middle.
Sure.
It's around there.
Yeah, the focus has got to be on the subject.
Yeah.
Sometimes the focus, the subject is in the middle, but it's up to the side. But I make sure that that area is bright. So I'll create a vignette.
Yeah.
And then I'll duplicate that, invert it, and then make and then just increase the exposure or just some
the
other
thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're asking all the secrets.
No. That is a good point, because is any other reference that maybe do you recommend us to have a look, other people or the artists that maybe is your reference as well that we can?
Sure, yeah. My reference, if you want to look up somebody and see what they do, you can look up visuals of Julius.
Julius?
Yeah, visuals of Julius. He's got some good tutorials. I've actually bought a few tutorials online. So I bought visuals of Julius, Joyd Hammonds, Michael Shane Boom, I think his name is. He's an American guy.
Yeah.
And they all teach the same thing.
Yeah.
Pretty much. I mean, I probably overdid it with the tutorials.
That's good. And I told you before we started the podcast, a couple of months ago, I saw in your Instagram stories that you bought a really expensive display to edit your photos, which is the Apple Cinema or Apple Display.
Apple Display. Yeah.
Apple Display.
Yeah, Studio Display.
First, the price of that display is like $2,500 grand,
sure,
something like that, right?
Yeah.
And how do you notice the difference between a kind of a normal display with this one?
Yeah.
How would it improves your workflow every day?
Mainly the size of it, but I've never edited images on anything other than Apple.
Yeah.
Apple have the Retina screens. I don't know the technical side of that, but the Retina pretty much helps with the quality.
Yeah.
And just having that bigger screen size, you can see all the imperfections in your work, so you can get better. And plus, you don't have to squint and lean forward, and you can lean back and you can look at it, and it's just much bigger in your face and it's easier to work with.
Exactly.
Yeah. The resolution's higher, the brightness is higher. Everything's just easier to work with.
Yeah. And it's a personal question as well. Do you try to trick a little bit your composition in post, like use a little bit of Photoshop as well?
Sure.
How is your workflow? Sometimes the photo came out like by itself, or maybe you have to trick some stuff, because I can see, I don't know, the moon, it sometimes is huge and I don't know, you know, it's amazing. Plus, you are a nice photographer.
Sure.
I can see that you are a nice compositor, right?
Yeah.
Your composition is really, really great.
It's his graphic design side.
Yeah. So I'm glad you mentioned that, because I used to shoot an image, and if it wasn't right, I would correct it.
Yeah.
And I would cut out pieces of the image, and I would make them into a composition that I liked. And over time, that actually helped me.
Yeah.
When I was out shoot better compositions.
Yeah.
Although some purists call it cheating.
Yeah.
For me, originally, it was just all about making something look nice. But over time, I actually become more of a purist myself, and I don't really do that anymore.
Wow.
I prefer to get it in the camera.
Okay.
There's some things that I will do.
Mm-hmm. Like clean up the image, of course.
Clean up the image. For example, I shot at the library.
Uh-huh.
So there's a side of the library that nobody really sees, and it's got like like some vegetation, and it used to have a little waterfall there. I don't know if you've seen it. So if you walk to
which library?
Oh, sorry, the City of Perth Library.
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah. The rounded one.
Yeah, yeah, the rounded one. But when you come to the side of it, there's just a little alleyway. There's no wall to there anymore. You can just walk through.
Yeah,
so I was taking a shot there. There was somebody in the library choosing a book at night while the lights were on.
Yeah.
And I wanted someone to walk past. And they didn't walk past at the same time. But they did walk past eventually. So I shot them separately and then I...
Yeah.
Sometimes it doesn't work. And when you've been three times, you're like, I'm not coming again. you're going in Photoshop. Yeah, okay.
And I come with the last one, very last, which is, I think, what I saw since 2020, the amount of people that maybe used to buy photography frames, right, to put it at home, and how is the market about that nowadays? Because I saw your website that you are selling your prints.
Sure.
They are amazing. But have you seen like a changing on that? That maybe the people approach to you to maybe buy just a digital file?
Sure.
Or is the how is the amount of sales that you have of, if you have more digital sales now?
Sure. Prints are weird because prints are a luxury for people and they want to buy them and they message you and then you message them back and you don't hear from them again. So with prints, you pretty much have to have this funnel where they can click and go straight to it. I don't really have that. I've got something that goes from Instagram to my website. So to be honest with you, I haven't had a massive amount of sales of prints. And mainly people don't want to buy the frames because they're expensive.
Exactly.
I recommend that they can go to Kmart or something, but I warn them that I don't know the frames and they could be cheap.
Yeah.
A good frame. A good frame isn't cheap at all.
Yeah.
Yeah. So mainly prints for me.
Yeah.
Without the frame.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I got it.
Yeah.
Anton, just recalling one thing that you said about artificial intelligence, right?
Mm-hmm.
How do you think that's gonna change our world when you talk about photography?
It's gonna put people out of a job for sure. People who were doing product shots, I think that's gonna become less. Headshots maybe, because you can now upload an image that you take with your phone, run it through an AI machine, and it'll give you something back. And it'll make
that's
you look
crazy.
And it'll make you look nicer as well, because you can give it a prompt that says smoother skin, no wrinkles.
Yeah.
Whiter teeth, you know. So
because I saw nowadays, like, if you know how to prompt properly on the AI tools or softwares, you basically can have the image that you want.
Yeah.
It's scary.
Yeah, it is, and it's I did a couple of tests and it just didn't feel right. I think for the hobbyist, it's not going to be a massive thing.
Mm-hmm.
I think street photography is where, this is my fault, that street photography is probably where people are going to gravitate towards, because they're the rawest moments that you can get. I think AI is going to be good for people who just want to create landscape stuff. I think that's where it might outshine photographers in landscape.
Uh-huh.
But for street photography, you know that moment happened the way it did and you didn't run it through an AI system. And you can run AI, you can say beautiful mountain, epic clouds, and you can get something really amazing from that.
Cool.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Hey, I think AI has changed so much and so quick,
sure.
Especially our equipment.
Yeah. What about yourself? Where do you think it's going to go?
I have no idea, because even our equipment, we can't keep it up with the technology. It's changing too fast.
Really? Yeah.
It's too fast.
Yeah.
When you talk about drones, it's even worse.
Really?
Yeah. For us, it's been a nightmare to keep it up with the technology.
Really?
So, yeah.
So you have to keep upgrading, but to upgrade is too expensive.
Pretty much downgrading.
Yeah. we used to do this often.
Yeah.
Now we start to hold a little bit.
Sure.
Because what's happening is, even DJI, I think they are cannibalizing everything, all their products.
Yeah.
So they launch one thing, the other, they launch another thing, and after they launch one big drone with the same capabilities of the small drone, so it starts to be weird.
Sure, yeah.
They're the market, so And also for you to upgrade your equipment, need to have like a project that justify that.
Yeah.
It's not all the time that you're having those big projects anymore. So
sure.
It's weird.
I tried to get some batteries for the Mavic 2 and no one sold them singly anywhere. This was a year ago. I went into the DJI shop in Carousel, Cannington, and they didn't have any. And you go onto the website, DJI's website, and there's no single one for sale.
No.
And I contacted them. They said, yeah, we're still selling them, but I think they're just phasing it out.
No, they removed it.
Yeah, they removed it. Yeah, and they told me they didn't. But they sent me some new ones because mine had bubbled underneath.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, they bubbled and they were almost popping out, so I couldn't fire them anymore. But if I didn't have that problem, I don't know if I'd have got some more batteries. So I don't know where I'm going to get my future batteries from. Also, Power Pro have discontinued the filters.
Jesus.
Which is a sign that the Mavic 2 isn't, they're not making anything else for the Mavic 2.
And for us that fly, for example, we have to fly sometimes on boats, right?
Mm.
And Mavic 2 was really good because you can remove, turn off all the sensors, everything, and you could bring the drone back.
Sure.
With the Mavic 3, other day we were in the middle of the ocean, and the drone didn't come back.
Wow.
And I couldn't land, and it was raining, rain, and the boat was all metal.
The drone was kind of 3, 4, 5 meters away of us, but it wanted to land, come to us.
We'll
stay there. It was crazy.
Those drones, we don't have autonomy to do anything that we want. For example, I can still with the Inspire 2, the Mavic 2. I don't have the Mavic 2 anymore, but the Inspire 2 is still bring and do what I want.
Sure.
The Mavic 3 is a nightmare. Every time that I have to go in the boat, you say, oh my.
You can't even turn off all the sensors. It's still.
No.
I was in Penang January and I was on a little hut. It was a really nice hut. It was on some rocks. I didn't have much battery left, but I was doing I had enough. It wasn't on low, but I was doing a reverse video.
Uh-huh.
So it would reveal and I brought it in and it started beeping and I could not get it back through this. It wasn't even a window. It was just two wooden poles.
No.
I had to climb down this and it wasn't a good looking shack either. It could have been dangerous. I got it in the end, but yeah, I've had that with the Mavic 2 where it just wouldn't come back to me.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's weird.
Yeah. And it wasn't, there was no metal there either.
You're looking for the future. What are your next projects? What are the things that you have in mind? What do you want to do with photography?
Sure. Yeah. So my main goal is to run my own real estate business.
Uh-huh.
It's going to take a while. Like I said before, I want to use AI if I can in the future. That's my thinking, that something's going to come out and I'm going to be able to take advantage of it. Rather than outsource and spend extra money on editing. But then for my personal side of photography, I'm looking for just my own personal project ideas. I've got some things that I want to do around Perth that I think are very Perth that I don't think anybody has recognised. But there is a lot of specific things about Perth that I've not seen pictures taken of. Like really specific.
This is the project for 2023?
Yes, 23.
So guys, stay tuned. By the end of 2023, Anton Wilk will launch something amazing.
If I don't, then you should be sending me messages.
If you don't, 2024, you'll be there year.
Unfollow me.
Talking about following, where people can follow you and see your amazing photos. And
sure, yeah. I'm on Instagram at anton.wilk. Facebook, Anton Wilk, and my website, antonwilk.com. I've just kind of reinvented my website. I have done I did a job in Carragini, which I'm going to put up there. I did a job for Tourism WA in Exmouth, which nobody has really seen that side of. So I'm going to put those up there and show the other projects that I have done.
That's good.
Yeah, yeah. We went to Carragini with Space Chameleon. Space Chameleon does the abseiling into the gorges.
He's
the only one that goes into the gorges at the bottom. And I spent a week with him shooting photos.
We love abseiling, hey?
Yeah,
it's nice up there.
Yeah, I just lost one drone shooting abseiling.
Oh, really?
Mavic 3.
Oh, really?
Beautiful.
Oh, you guys.
We ended up shooting with my Mavic Air 2.
Luckily, he was with his own Mavic as well.
So. And he was depressed. Yeah. I said, do you want me to shoot? Like, he didn't say anything. Oh, so no. I started doing all the shots that they did before by myself. He didn't say anything because he was so pissed off.
How did you lose it? What happened?
Man, that was my purely mistake, right? Sure. So I was flying really close to the cliff.
Yeah.
And when I going down, the drone hit like a branch.
Oh.
But hit the branch, it wobbled. What's happening is it wobbled and hit the cliff.
Yeah.
But because I didn't remember what was the position of the drone.
Yeah.
So I put forward,
yeah,
and the forward was coming back again to the cliff. So I hit the cliff again to the water.
Same thing happened to me.
Really?
I was facing the opposite way, and I went, oh, left. And then, because it was going to hit the tree, and it was bleeping, and I panicked, and I pressed left instead of right.
And
hit the tree, dropped down about 30 meters.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah.
Boy.
So I've crashed two drones now.
Jesus.
So that was one of them, and the other one was, I think... I don't know where it was now. I was close to water, and I don't know if you've observed this before, but when you're close to water, the propellers push the water down.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the sensor always thinks it's a specific distance from the water.
And
so
it goes down.
Yeah, it keeps going lower.
Exactly.
And so I was flying, and something happened, and one of the propellers clipped.
No.
Yeah, yeah. And it went up in the air, and it was just spinning.
Spinning in the water.
Yeah.
Jesus,
gone.
Man. Yeah, no. I never crashed the drones. Cool. Anton, thank you so much for coming here.
Sure.
Really appreciate everything that you said to us.
Sure.
And see you next time. Hey, man. Yeah, we always try to keep here and do like kind of a BTS.
Oh,
and,
yeah. Okay.
I remember when we met the first time was definitely there on the, I forgot the name.
Forest Chase.
It was Forest Chase, but it was not on the day that they have...
I think they had a light show on.
Yes.
Laser show.
The laser show.
Yeah.
They pretty much put like smoke.
Yeah. That was 2019 because I went to Japan about 1 week later, 2 weeks later.
That was crazy.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Anton, thank you so much.
Thank you. Cheers.
We appreciate it.